Good evening. I'm extremely happy to be all here tonight for this very special talk, so thank you very much for being part of this event. Our incomparable guest this evening is Mark Leckie, and I'd like to make a small introduction about him before he comes to the stage. Mark Leckie is an artist that produces work in order to understand things. During his career, he has developed such a rich and complex oeuvre that he's become a signature reference for a younger generation of artists, which is why I think it's very interesting to have him here tonight at this point of his life. Born in 1964 in the north of England, he always felt like living in the periphery of things, where things are actually happening the whole time. He says he can only understand objects and things when he has them on the screen, while he teases them as moving images, when he's able to manipulate them and to get the hold of these objects in his own work, in a multidisciplinary practice that encompasses sculpture, sound, film, and performance. Leckie explores the potential of the human imagination to appropriate and to animate a concept, an object, or an environment. As you might know, he was awarded the Turner Prize in 2008, and his work has been widely exhibited internationally, including solo exhibitions at Kunstverein Kunstverein, Cologne, in 2008, and at Le Consortium Dijon in 2007. Please join me in welcoming Mark Leckie.
This presentation is an attempt by me to try and grasp a particular experience that I have with certain things in the world. Things that appear as images or pictures, but that somehow impose on me a sense of their actual weight, density, and volume, of their physical being in the world. This sensation is then even further enhanced when a picture starts to move, when it comes to life. So I've called this experience I'm going to present it in four chapters. The first one is meat and potatoes. I'm beginning this chapter with the paintings of Philip Guston because they are meat and they are potatoes. They're down to earth and they're a bit ham-fisted. They are dumb and they are dumberer. They're thick as a brick and a bit pudding-headed. But most of all, they are mental and they are matter. They are both images and things. So they are hunks and they are lumps. They are dunce and they are dense. And they are thunk and they are stuff. They're thunk and stuff. And as paintings that feel like sculptures, or as the Campbell's advert said back then, they are soup that eats like a meal. So how can something that is as basically flat and two-dimensional as a painting, and as Mickey Mouse as these crude images, muster something so physical and so weighty, and in turn channel its effect through my body? So I become as engorged as these big throbbing heads. Like I'm stewed in the same juices. All of these paintings, this now is Bazalet's PD feet, seem to produce an effect that you only ever really encounter through severe injury, of the body being an organisation, a corporate arrangement of limbs and organs held together by its material support. And it's only through physical trauma that you get a real sense of the relative position of the individual parts to each other. For example, your leg to your foot, your arm to your knee, your chest to your back, or your head to your arse, all throbbing and pumping away single-handedly. Here, though, these limbs have suffered what surgeons would call an avulsion fracture, a separation of one body part from another, and they have gained independent activity. Basilitz's headless feet walk by themselves with deep satisfaction of sensation, while Guston labours to make a golem, an animated being created from inanimate matter.
So I said, well, why don't we put a mirror there and have James look inside the mirror? It's just as though you have visually resurrected the phantom limb. And of course, the patient knows it's an illusion, but it's very, very compelling.
Right now, as you look in there and you move your hand, your phantom does the same thing as your left hand is doing. First time I got in here and I've done this, and it was just like, it relieved the phantom pain, unclenched it. You know, it was just, oh, so intriguing, you know. Sometimes it's hard to explain how you felt, you know.
I've kebabbed this piece, which is about a lack of something, smack dab in the middle of works which are all about an excess of things exceeding and exaggerating themselves so as to draw attention to their presence, their being in the world. These works could be called a prunkstilleven or ostentatious still life, which was a genre of 17th century Dutch painting. They seem to threaten to spill out of themselves. So here's a couple of overabundantly unstill lives by Gilbert and George.
Here in the dreamland of our anxious night, the fruits behave. They speak and turn and roll with us with unending orgasms. Incest with varieties proud in mainline pedigree, distorted in closed thought and separated sense. Life in the cut-down object pieces groans for new turns and movements. Frustrated with their limited beings, they bump together, yearning for new chance in action. Heavy with doomed history, optimistic with their cranky dream, they push fruitily on through the orgiastic old hours. With us they love, and we, through their night dream, love reason with our passion. Strange weights, textures, flesh, and seed move here for the scream of reason. Here, with the handsome beauty of the daily food, these pools of juices and mounds of dead matter, giving us our necessary breathing life and intellect. Sliced pig to bacon with fats and veins drool into our pleasure of eating. Disgusting sausages taste so nice with deep bowel satisfaction of sensation. Cabbage come and potato go as fixed drab sadness for our gullets. Sheep chops lie in beauty with dead ribbed happiness of purpose. Gravy rivers round raw rind of belly. Curlicules of fat decorating its way to masticated end. Steamed up air above the stewed stew, stewing for its winter stench smell loveliness. With puddings of sweat, solid with the cornfield's gold, and aching with travelled sun-cursed sugar, all drenched in good yellow-shirted custard. Tarts fall and crumble, as crumbles various stand dust dry, but moist with mystery of excellence.
Okay, that was Gilbert and George from a video called The World of Gilbert and George.
And this is a music video that was made by a company called Encyclopedia Pictura, who are from San Francisco. In this, you're going to see people perform an action in which they transform themselves into ferrofluid, which is a liquid that becomes strongly polarized in the presence of a magnetic field. And in the inverse of what was missing from the last video, the mirror box piece, they extend themselves into one massive limb before unclenching and reforming into their separate selves.
This is a music video and I'm going to play some of my music over the top.
That was Encyclopedia Pictura and the last bit of Meat and Potatoes. The next chapter is... This is a chapter about cats, creatures whose aliveness I've always found ambiguous, as they seem to inhabit a crepuscular state between the quick and the dead. So I'll begin with a statue of a cat statue, a cat like that. Because when I started thinking, what was the earliest sculpture, I thought of this Ubast cat, that is the sculpture, the archetype or the cat type of statuary. This is because I think there is something about the cat, the living ones, that's kind of already like sculpture. I don't know if it's because its form is so simple and basic, or because their serenity and unnerving stillness can sometimes lead to a confusion about their vitality, but they always seem to bring about a fascination with trying to make them come to life, either as statues or as cartoons. So the first cartoon cat that came to mind was George Herriman's Crazy Cat, because Guston was a big fan, and he described his own work as agitating chunks of matter in uncertain space. And these drawings are made of the same swollen stuff. But this three-dimensionality could not be extended into the fourth, because when they tried to animate these pictures, make them move in space, they just flattened out. They failed to galvanize. It just didn't come to life. So my curiosity then led me further through the clouder of cartoon cats until I found Felix. A product of the Jazz Age, Felix the Cat was the first merchandised cartoon character, manifesting himself as clock, doll, mug, bag, magnet, and other knick-knacks. These images are from the first broadcasting experiments produced by the RCA Studios in the 1930s, which used a doll of Felix the Cat to test its transmissions. The apparatus is a mechanical scanner, and it is the earliest form of television. The device could transmit pictures, moving pictures, electronically through the air and reassemble them in front of an audience at home. An audience so early in its development, it just hadn't been named yet. So if you were a teleseer, telepreceptor, telespector, a televist, a telegazer, an aud observer, an audo seer, an audo vist, an invider, an engazer, visualizer, visioner, or eventually a viewer, this is what you'd see. I'm going to show Felix in a compilation of his cartoons from the late 20s. There is something about these drawings that is so thick and weighty that they become almost palpable. As Otto Messmer, who drew Felix, said, solid black moves better. It's like watching pure matter moving about. These are living pictures. So that was Felix the Cat in Woo's Whoopee and Comic Calamities. And this is his progeny. Careering wildly through three dimensions of space, or even four to five for all I know, skating on the furthest edge of plausibility, Impertinently, he hoists himself into a world of innumerable and elastic dimensions and limitless possibilities, in which every tree and stone has not only potential life, but a complete set of emotions. That wasn't said about Garfield, that was said actually about Felix.
Garfield was very different when I first started doing him back in 1978. There's been almost this Darwinian evolution of the character in that he had expressive parts that were actually very small to begin with. He had these little tiny beady eyes, and then he had these big rabbit ears. And you notice he didn't smile very much back then, and these great big fat cheeks. And he looked like a sort of a big giant lump of clay. Still had those stripes right here, but he sat on this big base. He didn't move very much, little tiny tail, little tiny toes, like this. He's just pretty much of a couch potato. Sat around, took pot shots at life.
Eisenstein was a big fan of Disney, and he wrote enthusiastically on the subject of animation. He describes the ecstasy of sensing and experiencing the primal omnipotence, the element of coming into being and the plasmaticness of existence within the cartoon animated world from which anything can arise. He refers to Disney's animation as beyond any image, without an image, beyond tangibility, like a pure sensation. It's that without an image that entrances me. So they're just a feeling. The cinema I'm after.
Films which impose themselves on the spectator through a sort of domination of visual and sound events, and which require the screen, the big screen, to be effective. These are films.
That's a quote from Jack Rivette. Like a pure sensation. This chapter ends with a few more rotating animal sculptures, or more properly, a glyptozoetrope. The first is a short excerpt taken from General Ideas' 1985 video, Shut the Fuck Up. And that's followed by Jeff Koons' stainless steel rabbit, which is installed in my flat. And the last one is a short animation test piece by Tim Bacon and Machenda Wheeler. Oh, bliss, bliss and heaven. Oh, it was gorgeousness and gorgeousity made flesh. It was like a bird of rarest spun heaven metal, or like silvery wine flowing in a spaceship. Gravity, all nonsense now. As I slushied, I knew such lovely pictures.
Thank you.
One of the reasons for putting this program together was to try and figure out why a revolving poodle, an awkward duck, and Guston's big head could hold such a fascination for me. I've always thought that Titanic is actually another of James Cameron's sci-fi films. He directed Aliens, Terminator, and The Abyss. His films are endless explorations of the relationship between man and technology. Titanic, then, for me, is actually a time travel film that shuttles between the bookends of the 20th century. Leonardo DiCaprio is contemporary with us. All the other actors are playing period, but he is a modern American. The theme of the film is based on Marx's phrase, all that is solid melts into air. Cameron uses this idea to describe how the manifest materiality of heavy industry at the beginning of the century then dissolves into the impalpable intangibility of software processing by its end, where everything has become an image. The film is also this great encounter between two sculptural equivalents, this massive metal assemblage smashing into this enormous icy earthwork. I once read a quote by the critic Jerry Saltz that said the movie Titanic is a story of a form going from pure horizontality to total verticality. And here is Homer about to be transformed from horizontal to vertical.
Huh? I never looked behind this whatchamacallit case before.
Oh, glory of glories. Oh, heavenly testament to the eternal majesty of God's creation.
Holy macaroni!
What's going on here? I'm so bulgy. My stomach sticks way out in front and my...
It's like you just disappeared into fat air.
Hey, shut up!
Here is an ordinary square.
Whoa, whoa, slow down, Egghead.
But suppose we extend the square beyond the two dimensions of our universe along the hypothetical z-axis there. This forms a three-dimensional object known as a cube or a frincahedron in honor of its discoverer. Hey, hey.
Help me! Are you helping me or are you going on and on?
Oh, right, and of course within we find the doomed individual.
Hello?
Oh my God, look at you. Oh, mommy, go to you. Oh, my. Oh.
And there was so much. Tons and tons of existence. Endless. Mounting up. Mounting up as high as the sky. Spilling over. Filling everything with its gelatinous slither. And I could see depths upon depths of it, reaching far beyond the limits of the street, the people and buildings, as far as the eye could reach. This is a picture of Homer if he was a real person. I've tried to find a place for him on this diagram. The Uncanny Valley was devised by the roboticist Mashiro Mori. It charts the negative emotional response towards robots and other non-beings that appear overly lifelike in both motion and appearance. It also reveals, though, the need for the almost real, or how best to represent the illusion of life. To invent a machine that produced this illusion of life was the desire of the animation studios of the 1930s. The multiplane, as used by Disney, was an apparatus that stacked several layers of glass at varying distances from the camera. On each of these panes was painted a different plane of the background scenery, which was then pushed and pulled in and out of frame and focus. The output of the multiplane then is both satisfyingly painterly and mechanistic, a mechanical painting process of industrial landscapes, motorized scenery, and automated panoramas. It is a sculpture producing an expanded field. The multiplane is an example of what has been called the technology of enchantment and the enchantment of technology, or better still, the magic of Disney.
This is me, here, in this nature theatre, on plein air. Here, with the machine in the forest, watching the film rushes, deep in the uncanny valley, creeping through the underpainting, Sodor Bosco, lost in its verdant verisimilitude, watching it all unspool.
The next chapter is called Now here are some sculptures by Fishley and Weiss. The sculptures they made for their Objects from a Raft series are polyurethane imitations of flotsam and jetsam, the definition of which is goods of potential value that have been lost at sea. Now, polyurethane is a polymer, a chemical compound made of long chains of repeating units that can be quite literally made into anything. It's the most ubiquitous modern material. It actually makes up most of the stuff we know. It's kind of like cartoon matter in that it can create a world of innumerable and elastic dimensions and limitless possibilities. Being made of exactly the same substance, though, robs each of these items of their usefulness or utility and gives them all an equivalence. The chair is a potato, is a shoe, is a book, is a pig, is a crate, is a cannon, is a fish, is a flipper, is a sack, is a chair again. They're all just stuff, chunks of matter in an uncertain space. And what I feel from looking at these chunks of stuff, these blobs of matter, these kind of limitless globs, is that you can zoom out from them to the whole wide world, which then is itself just a glob, hanging in a mass of other vaster and greater globs within a whole universe made of the same chunky, blobby, globby stuff. This was an advert for a machine. The advert was called the Cog. The Cog was similar to The Way Things Go by Fishley and Weiss. This version, though, is the inverse of the Swiss duo's work, because it appears to me sort of flat and frieze-like, like it's all on one plane, like a large glass. Each of its components seems sort of weightless and unattached. In fact, it reminds me more of the multiplane, different layers of mechanical animation going on. It actually seems more like a drawing, like pictograms or some sort of hieroglyphic Haynes Workshop manual, all its manifold parts on display. Actually, it's more kind of like a sort of pixelized rendering of one of those Louis the 15th mechanical toys, or sort of filigree fancy.
Oh, hold on.
The chocolate grinder sets in motion the reciprocating gear untiringly performs, eternally doing and throwing, circling and circling. The chocolate grinder is self-enclosed. The chocolate grinder circles monotonously, repetitively. The bachelor grinds his own chocolate, which is coming from, I don't know where, but it eventually deposits itself after grinding.
The cog is followed by another bachelor grinding his chocolate. This one is all organic roundness as opposed to the cog's inorganic angularity. But both believe in the process of perpetual motion to get to the bride. The rock in that Chuck Jones cartoon is a great caricature of a rock. It really embodies rockness. I came across this quote that describes this quiddity perfectly. These feet, so unreal, are curiously human. They are ironic feet, and therefore a supreme quality in cartooning, touchingly pathetic. This painting is how a foot thinks of a shoe. It is the body's impression of its lowest life form. It's a caricature of its own physiognomy. These pictures represent, in a deadpan way, shoeness. But they are more than just an image of a shoe, more than just a representation. These things are here, embodied in the screen, like a footprint. They may point towards their physical origins elsewhere, but they're also present here in this cinema as well. To add to their pathos, whoever inhabited these shoes has abandoned them. They are forlorn as a cast-off prosthetic limb or a ventriloquist's doll that has become disarmed from its partner. That's not what I meant. It's just you have this quality that's kind of beguiling. How can I explain? You're not just provisional. And you're more than a likeness, and you're certainly not a replica. You're not a shadow, or an apparition, or even an impression. You're not the shoe in itself, but neither are you just a shoe sign. It's like you're oscillating between an image and an object, especially when you're up there, big, on the screen like that. I can almost physically feel you. You're sort of resonating at a very low pitch. You become almost audible, but hardly visible. You've gone right near the edge of seeing. You're beyond an image. You're without an image. You've gone beyond tangibility, like a pure sensation. The end of the program is a 16mm still life by Hollis Frampton called Lemon. It is the most concentrated segment of this presentation. For as the lemon waxes and wanes, it will go from pure horizontality, an image, to total verticality, an object.
got any questions, we can pass the microphone around.